Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us today. If you haven't already, please, this would be a good time to silence your cell phones. And at some point in the memorial service, there will be an invitation to come up and share memories. Just come on up and you can leave the mic right where it's at. It'll be more than able to pick you up. At this moment, if we could please rise as we begin military honors.
Bye.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, your glory and grace shines brightly on us today. We thank you for this opportunity to come in and celebrate the life of Alan Durfee, and we just ask that you fill this room, fill the hearts of those attending, comfort that of the family, and let us see towards hope through the message and celebration of Alan's life today, that while we have breath in our lungs, we are still on mission and purpose for you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. And please join us in worship.
Forever mine.
Dylan Durfee of Prescott Valley. He was born June 14th, 1948 in Providence, Rhode Island. He loved his wife, Iris, sister Catherine, and his stepsons, Jason and Kelly, and their wives, Jennifer and Aurora. Alan was an avid and passionate golfer, and he was also a disabled American veteran who proudly served in the Army during the Vietnam conflict. He loved God, America, and his family. At this time, we'd like to extend an invitation to those of you who would like to share some memories about Alan, his life, what he meant to you, and just share your heart.
Good afternoon. I'm Jason McNeil. I'm Alan's stepson. And I'm going to read a couple letters. One from my son, Jordan, and one from my wife, and then I'll read my own. Jordan writes, Grandpa Durfee was always energetic and a loving grandfather, and my most memorable time spent with him was us watching our favorite movies together and going to the theaters. Even in sickness, he always was joyful and loved us all. Even friends of mine saw him as honorable because of his service in Vietnam, serving the fellow soldiers there and risking his life for them. We all will miss him, but I know he's at peace now in heaven, and we will see him again one day. Rest easy, Grandpa. And then this one is from my wife, Aurora. One of the memories that I most value with Dad is that we had homemade meals and we played hearts and Yahtzee. Somehow he always won at hearts. I think maybe he might have secretly marked the cards. LOL. But I did pretty well at Yahtzee. I remember the time that I had two consecutive Yahtzee rolls. Alan said, oh no, I am not going to play anymore. I enjoyed our family time together. Plus, I got a connection with him, and I love him as my real dad. He accepted me as his real daughter. I remember the time that Alan was sad and depressed, and we told him that we were pregnant with Michael. That's our one-year-old. And he said, now I have to live two or three more years in order to see the birth. And he did. He kept his promise. I am so grateful that he had time to spend with Michael. Alan somehow had a link to Michael. He even wore matching shirts with Michael without planning it beforehand. I'm grateful that we moved to Arizona in the beginning of 2017 and spent time with Mom and Alan. I'm grateful that I was able to share with him a few weeks ago that we are now expecting our second child. He will be missed. And this one's from me. One thing that I appreciate about Alan was that he took pride in the things that were important to him. He took great pride in his country. He took pride in his military service. He usually wore a hat around town, which signaled that he was a veteran and appreciated other veterans. He kept a flagpole in the front yard, proudly displaying the flag all day and illuminating it with a light all night. He took pride in his family too. I remember in the early months of his and my mom's marriage, I had not yet moved off to college and we all lived together. In some ways, Alan and I bumped heads during that time. But after I moved off to college, I began to appreciate how much he was proud of me. In college, I was quite an opinionated person, getting involved in various causes, writing a weekly column for the college newspaper. I mailed him and my mom a copy of one of my first opinion columns, and I remember thinking that they might be proud of the mere fact that I was allowed to write for the paper at all. But sometime later, my mom told me that Alan couldn't bear to not share my column. He even stopped the mailman one day as he was delivering his letters and read my entire column to the mailman. I was grateful that he took pride even in my writing. For years, I got a kick out of visualizing the scene, with Alan enthusiastically reading my words out loud and the mailman awkwardly but politely standing there listening. To this day, that whole episode is a fond memory. I remember Alan as an avid reader too. He used to have numerous books that he would talk about in detail, Stephen King novels being some of his favorites. I remember one time my son Jordan's mom wanted her son Mason to become more interested in books and reading. So Alan and my mom took up the challenge to record themselves reading the Chronicles of Narnia aloud and recording it on tape cassette. I remember Alan's voice on those recordings. He read the text attentively, and I believe it was his goal to convey the sense of wonder that those stories have offered to kids over the decades since they were published. I enjoyed playing games with Alan too. He was very competitive. Whenever my wife and I would visit, we tried to arrange some sort of game while we were there. Monopoly, Yahtzee, and especially card games. I'm amazed that despite my skill and experience in hearts, and the fact that I almost beat all the players many times, Alan almost always won. As we played, he would make remarks that showed that he was highly attentive and would even recommend strategies to us to help us beat him. But as we played, all four of us smiled, made jokes, just enjoyed ourselves. We enjoyed each other's company, and all of us enjoyed spending time with Alan. Going all the way back to 1990, I remember enjoying spending time with Alan, especially our weeks-long trip around the United States in a fifth-wheel trailer. Alan wanted everyone to experience the sights and destinations, and he put in 99% of the driving on that trip. He always wanted everyone to enjoy themselves, even reading the words on the screen to my mom whenever we went to the movies. I'll remember Alan for all these reasons. I'm proud of him too. I'll miss him.
Alan married my mother at the beginning of my teenage years. It was roughly a year and a half after my biological father passed away. This is a time when a young boy is arguably in most need of the positive influences that a father offers. A father is needed to show what true masculinity is, how a man must respect and honor his wife, be firm and fair to his children, be true to his convictions, as well as to provide for his family. Alan was a spectacular role model to me and for all these things, and I carry these characteristics to this day, and I tribute him for it. It's safe to say that Alan's life had a large positive effect on the man I am today. When loved ones pass, it's not uncommon when speaking of their life to focus on the big accomplishments, the big impactful moments, the most significant areas that an individual's life had and how they affected us and the world around them. The reason for this is because we're all ultimately defined by what we do. While Alan was certainly had these large and overarching characteristics, among them are some I just referenced, I feel that the little moments sometimes get overlooked in these scenarios. Though they may not affect all of us in the aforementioned large and overarching kind of ways, I believe that the small interactions can be as impactful and maybe even more so for each of us, at least on an individual level. I'd like to take this time to share one of those small interactions that had a big impact on me and my life as we celebrate the life of Alan, my dad. Shortly after he and my mother married, we, Alan, my mother, brother, and myself, went on a family vacation across the country throughout the summer break. We drove in a pickup truck while towing a fifth-wheel trailer to nearly 35 of these United States while experiencing each local tourist trap, sampling of beautiful scenery, local culture, and food that each destination had to offer along the way. Regarding food, to those of us that knew him well, no one could say that Alan was not a connoisseur of, and sometimes excess eater of, good food. I distinctly recall how excited he was when the opportunity to taste the best of the local flavor that each town had to offer as we traveled. For example, though we started in California, when we hit Arizona, the menu was tacos. When we reached New Mexico, it was chimichangas. He couldn't hit Texas without an order of ribs. And when we hit Louisiana, crawfish etouffee was on the plate. Every stop along the way was something unique and special to that region. It was a foodie's paradise, and Alan was living the dream. I, on the other hand, didn't have a very elaborate palate of, or inclination to try anything new or exotic. I certainly wasn't going to eat anything like crawfish etouffee as he did at the time. If I were to have written a book about my food choices during that trip, it might be titled Hamburgers Across America. Alan's excitement of each food destination was always, but briefly, stifled with expressions of real frustration and sometimes even anger that I didn't want to try something new. But I didn't want something new. I was hungry, and I knew that if I experimented with something different, I might not like it, wouldn't eat it, but would be expected to. I would just end up getting hangry, and intense frustration would be had by all, and the vacation would probably be ruined. You could say that eating a hamburger was my special gift to the family. I'm good like that. You're welcome. That sounds funny now, but that was absolutely my way of thinking at the time. Later in life, I learned that Alan mistakenly assumed that my lack of food curiosity throughout that trip was rebelliousness and even an expression of retaliation for marrying my mother. Nothing, of course, could have been further from the truth. Alan and I had always a good relationship while I was growing up, and I'm glad that I was able to clear that point of concern for him, even if it was only as an adult that I was able to do so. Now, as I'm raising two kids, one of with very extreme food preferences, I recently experienced deja vu when I asked one of them to try something new, to which I received the response, "I might not like it, won't eat it, and I know you expect me to, and you're just going to get mad." It was then that I realized that I'm raising myself and that apparently I've become my father. But I also realized that it was those events as a child which gave me the perspective I needed to be patient with my own children and ultimately free them to write their own rendition of Hamburgers Across America. Interestingly, and I suppose ironically enough, as an adult, Louisiana has subsequently become my favorite tourist destination. Their crawfish etouffee is among my most favorite foods. Thanks, Dad.
I'm Jenny. I'm Kelly's wife. Alan was a second father to me. Well, maybe a third father. I have many, but as it goes, Alan proved by the acceptance of my husband as his child, that DNA really doesn't matter. I was blessed to have my own father adopt me as a young child when my father decided to not stick around, and also was blessed to have a very involved grandfather. Alan, I met at the ripe old age of 19 when Kelly brought me home for our first Christmas together, and he wasn't sure what to make of me. I have a very outgoing personality. I'm very kind of in your face, and Alan wasn't quite sure how to deal with that. I think he and Mom were very angry with me because at one point they bought a car and they paid full price and didn't care and were very happy and proud to show us the calendar that they received for their overpriced purchase. And so I think were a little bit offended that, you know, we were kind of giving them a little nudge that, you know, next time, call us. We'll show you how to buy a car, even though we're the kids. Alan was a great guy. He'd come over for Christmas, and we'd play Monopoly, and he was a terrible sore loser. He would get up in the middle of, as he ran out of Monopoly money, the game was over. It didn't matter if, you know, everybody else was winning. It doesn't matter who it was. But he just did not want to play anymore. He showed me how he exemplified being a respectful and thoughtful husband to my mother-in-law. He was always putting her first in everything he did. He was very faithful, kind father to my husband. And when we brought our children home, who are also not biologically ours because my plumbing is broken, he didn't think twice about accepting them as his own grandchildren, as if I had birthed them and they were Kelly's biologically. So I appreciated that welcomeness from him as we grew our family. He loved his grandson, Josh. Josh is very unique, and Alan was very patient with him and would sit with him for hours and take him to do the strangest of things that Josh enjoys doing. And with Sydney, he was hopeful that she would be the golf prodigy that he was hoping the first two grandchildren would be that didn't pan out. And she just kind of didn't care to learn the game and would just pick up the ball and put it in the hole in the backyard on the putting green. And he was just so upset that this was not going as he had hoped. I will remember Alan for a variety of reasons, but mostly because he was a great dad. He just was a good guy, proud of his country, proud to have served. Jason mentioned he always had the flag up in the yard, and he just was so proud to be an American. Would let you know about his military service, what he thought of the current state of affairs politically, and didn't care. My kind of guy. So, if you make you mad, I'm sorry, but this is who I am. So he was always just such a good guy, and you knew where you knew what you were getting. He's very much like myself, is what you see is what you get. And we bonded over that. Dad also liked his beer. And I married into what we thought was a large Irish family. None of them drank. So I had to go and have my father-in-law as a drinking buddy when we went out to family dinners. And they turned out not to be really Irish anyways, according to Ancestry. But maybe that's what the problem was. But anyways, Alan will be missed. He was a wonderful man. I will miss him dearly. I'm sure, you know, everybody will in their own way. But I was blessed to have met him, to have spent 27 years of my life knowing him. And I was very happy and blessed to have him as a grandfather to my children. So play golf in heaven, and if you find Grandpa Ralph, go fishing for me.
I am the most blessed of women. each of you who are here today has impacted me profoundly and in very individual ways. And I am absolutely humbled at your kindnesses and generosity of spirit. I'd like to offer my sincere gratitude and appreciation for being here, but there are a few I'd like to single out. First, I'd like to thank Brian Moltrap for his initial response to my call to Heights in order to report Alan's passing. He immediately set things in motion, and that gave me such comfort. I wanted someone to do something, and he did. And within a few days, I was meeting with him and Leah Brunzer. Leah is the one who created the video you're going to be seeing in a few moments, as well as the little family gift bags and the music and the setup along with Brian here at H2. Although I have known her only since the August afternoon when she and Brian and I met under the veranda just outside this room, she has become my sister. She has spent an inordinate amount of time comforting me, and just a minute, and it's coming, and answering a bazillion questions, and with the patience and grace that I am in utter awe of her. I would also like to thank the military personnel for coming and doing this honor for Alan. He would have been so proud, and someday he will know if he knew about this. It was touching, and I will not ever forget it. I have five nieces and nephews with whom I love to the core. Two of them have come from the state of Washington in order to be here today. My late sister Jo's eldest daughter, Stacy, drove here by herself, in order to help me the few days leading up to and following this service. I am humbled by such generosity. Thank you, Stacy. My late sister Sharon's son, Jimmy, is today's message giver. You'll hear him in a few moments. He and I have been having small, regular Bible studies for years, and even though I'm at least 16 years older than he is, I have learned so much from him, not only of the Bible, but also about humility and grace and mercy walked out. Thank you, Jimmy. My sons and daughters-in-law, Jason, Kelly, Jenny, and Aurora, have been such godly servants to me. They have driven up here from Phoenix multiple times to help me sort through Alan's things and to help me disperse them. They've been strong for me, and I love them profoundly and recognize the gift from God that they are. Alan was absolutely crazy about these four and thought of them as his own kids, with absolutely no reservations. As you can probably tell from the video that you're going to see, those sons and daughters gave us five grandchildren who have given us uncommon joy. Their names are Jordan, over here, Josh, Sydney, Michael, and one to be announced in April. And we love those kids, and they are special to us. Casey, Alan's sister, and I and my family, thank you, our friends and family, for celebrating this life that my dear and good husband had. I want you to all know that he would have been touched to have known that you are here. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I know he must have heard the words that I long to hear someday as well. Well done, good and faithful servant.
Thank all of you guys for having me come and join you for this celebration of life well lived. I'd like to share a story about my uncle. The first time I met him, my Aunt Iris walked by me with this great big grin on her face. And I looked at Alan and I said, I've never seen that on my aunt's face. Ever. I love you. I knew that day you would become my favorite uncle. One of the things that I really, really cherished about him was his faith. That may sound a bit strange, because he wasn't one to go out and preach a sermon or do a mission, spend time with the church body. His passion was living Christ out with his family, living Christ out with his friends, living Christ out on the golf course, living Christ out in the fishing streams, living Christ out holding a grandchild. One of the most powerful influences in my Christian life. I thought I might share that with you. I got the extreme honor of being welcomed or being invited to come and share a message with you guys. I like to share messages, and I don't like to cry when I do them. If I cry, please forgive me. I'll ask in advance. I love this man very much. As I spent time going over the message, really it's a short message, and I thought it was specifically designed for this moment. I know we have a lot of moments in life where we go, oh, this piece of scripture was specifically designed for this moment. But in this case, I think it was really appropriate. Is there any way I could get some light up here, guys, so I can see what I'm doing? I want to share with you a piece of scripture, and I apologize. I've been trying to get all of this transposed into Alan's Bible. My aunt gave me the extreme privilege of giving me this Bible. And in the midst of going through it, I do have to admit some of my sermon has been changed because of the markings in Alan's Bible. But a piece that I wanted to share with you, and it comes from John 14. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me, says Jesus. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. In the King James, many mansions, many rooms. In my Father's house is many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. For I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way where I am going. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How do we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, know him, and you have seen him. This is important for us. Do you notice nowhere in here did I say I came here to mourn? I came here to celebrate my uncle. To celebrate a life well lived. To celebrate a man who served his country and his family and his friends honorably. There's a place prepared for him. And we've noticed on the handouts and going through this, preparing this, one of Alan's favorite verses, Romans 8:1. Now, therefore, there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Well, what's the therefore? Therefore, Christ, through his gift to us, through his sacrifice on the cross, he cleansed us. But there's another piece to this. It's through the open tomb that he's made a way for us to be with the Father, so that we can say Abba, Daddy, to the Maker. And there will be no condemnation. There will be no remembrance of that wrong that you did. There'll be no remembrance of the failures in our lives. There will only be the supreme victory of Jesus over death. This is what this scripture is saying to us. Jesus has prepared a place for us, and we can go and have no condemnation. Yes, we bury ashes. Yes, we bury bones. But we have not buried my uncle. We have not. I don't believe he's looking down here at us. I don't believe he cares a rap what we do down here. I think his face is so firmly fixed on the face of Jesus, he hasn't got time to stop and say, what are they doing down there? Singing no less days to sing his praise than when we first began to walk in faith and to sing his praise. This is the victory of the cross. This is why we don't mourn as others mourn. This isn't the end. It's not the end. Hebrews says it's appointed once for a man to die and then the judgment. Hear me today. You'll be judged through the blood of Christ and the victory of Christ, or you will be judged by your works. If that doesn't run a chill down each of your spines. This is why Romans 8:1 was so important to him, so important to me. If you're a Christian, it's important to you. When we get there and we are with the Father, he will look at us with love and have no memory of the wrong. He will cast it as far as the east is from the west. That's the power of the blood at the cross. And to be standing before him with eternal life, that's the victory over the grave. The victory that God has given to each of us who trust in him. We may not understand it all. We don't have to. We need to understand this. Jesus died for us because he loves us. But not only that, he rose for us so he could be with us for eternity. This is the message I wanted to bring. This is the message Alan wants you to hear. This is the message his family wants you to hear. If you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, please come talk to me. Please come and talk to the pastor in the back. Please come talk to one of us. We want to help you to understand what this is all about. We don't want you to make a decision in the emotion. We want you to make a decision in the brain. To understand this is not a fable. This is not a fictitious we hope. This is a fact we know. The grave is empty. We have the victory over death. So as we sit here, as we lament, as we remember the wonderful, wonderful life of Alan Durfee, remember what he's doing right now. Remember where he's at right now. Where he's at, there you can be also. This is important, guys. Rarely do we visit this issue except for deaths and births. We begin to understand that there's an end to this here. And then what? Are we worm food? Or do we have value? Were we designed? Is there a designer who loves us? And if so, what has he done to make us one of his? This is where we start in our faith, is recognizing we didn't measure up. We need his mercy and grace. We need to recognize where we've fallen short and accept his gift of his righteousness to make up the gap. This is the message of the cross. This is the message. I was preparing to do a closing benediction, and I really love Colossians 2. For somebody like me, it's literally Jesus Christ taking a big ugly stick and beating the devil with it. Because that's what he did. He stole the devil's slaves and captives and he set them free. He broke down the gates of hell and death and took the keys. and I love it so much. And in my preparation for it, like I said, I have borrowed Alan's Bible. And in Alan's Bible, strangely enough, as I've gone through this, I found a piece in here that I think is more important to be shared. And I think it's something that we struggle with, and it goes further than Romans 8:1. And we go through this, and it really he's talking about, therefore we have been, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law, the spirit of life in Jesus Christ has set you free from the law of sin and death. This was really important, Alan. This was precious to him. Precious to all of us who have been, all of us wretches who have been set free. So I want to share that with you as my closing message to you. Closing benediction to you, Romans 8:28, and we know that God causes all things to work together for those who love God and those who are called according to his purposes. So today, as we remember our uncle, our dad, our husband, our friend, our brother, we want to step back and remember, this is for a reason. This is all for a reason. If somebody hears the message today, if somebody hears the call from the altar today, to stand up and say, I want to know more. I want to be free. I want to live like Alan lived. I want to live fully alive. I want to know that God will work all things together for good, for those who love them, for those who love him, for my family, for my friends. This is his message to you. Now, therefore, there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your ear. And a blessing on each one of you today. God bless.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas. His hand the wonders wrought. Is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear him pass. He speaks to me everywhere. is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this time and these moments that you have provided us to celebrate Alan, that you have called home an amazing husband, father, brother, and friend. We just ask that you continue to move in our hearts and let us know that while we remember Alan in our minds, that we will continue to forever see him in our hearts. Lord, we thank you for the opportunities that you provide for us to grow closer to you. This blessing that you've provided us today to celebrate Alan will remain with us in hope as we continue to move forward for you and with you. It's in your heavenly name. Amen. It's truly been a blessing and a privilege to be here today and listen to some amazing stories about an even more amazing man. Thank you for joining us this afternoon, and we hope that you have a beautiful and wonderful remainder of your weekend. God bless. See?
can we celebrate who our God is today. He is great.